Oh, this is such a great book. It's got a rather amateurish looking cover, but you know, you don't judge a book by its cover. And I just really love reading and rereading and rereading this book. And I've had this since about 1990. And the author, Mike Brown, sent it to me. Long story. It came out in 1980, but I got it around 1990, along with some pretty interesting other books that he did. And we had some very interesting conversations. I never met him in person. Desert Publications, Cornville, Arizona. I would think that this book is out of print. There's the international standard book number. Okay. Now, this book, I really enjoyed this book, but I have no plans to return to the USA nor to work again in any legal capacity in the USA. And I did do lawsuits from here in France for about the first decade I was over here. That was fun and necessary. But I just really hope I don't have to do them anymore. Now, this says, this is probably the first How to Be Your Own Lawyer book ever written by a non-lawyer. There are two good reasons for this. The first is that if any members of the Bar Association divulged the information I am about to, he would be disbarred immediately, tarred, feathered, and run out of town on a rail for openers. The second is that every scrap of information I put in front of you is real. It works. I learned every bit of it the hard way, starting on September 10th, 1974, when the FBI arrested me and sent me to prison for 3.5 years, where I learned jailhouse law up until this book was written. He has a lot to say about the mistakes that jailhouse lawyers make also. It's really a wonderful book. During that time, I've won a number of cases, both in federal and state court. I lost some, too. You will understand why I lost the ones I did by the time you finish reading this book. Most of the ones I lost had absolutely nothing to do with the facts or the controlling principles of law on the case. Now, this book is just wonderful. How to use this book. I'm going to read this to you, okay? I'll try to make it quick. This is a How to Do It book. It simply covers the mechanics of how to sue someone else and hopefully win. It is not a philosophical treatise on what's wrong with the system or a collection of pre-printed forms on filling out a will, filing for divorce, etc. Every case in this book can be verified by actual court records, with two exceptions. On the first case, the names and the docket number of the case have been changed to protect the guilty. He wasn't really that bad a guy, and I don't feel it necessary to ridicule him publicly. The last case in the book is a textbook example of how to stop forced busing. I can't file it simply because my children are in no danger of being bused in rural Kentucky. The courts don't accept claims, petitions, or writs merely for the sake of academic exercise. The first thing that you must overcome to use this manual effectively is an awe of the law, the statutes, lawyers, and judges themselves. If you are easily intimidated, or in prison jargon, a trembler, you had better hang it up right at this point. If, on the other hand, you're one of the enraged few who has had it with law and lawyers, read on. You may find some real eye-openers. The second thing that you must overcome to use this manual effectively is a programmed ignorance being no fault of your own, but rather a series of myths perpetuated by those in whose interest the status quo lies, the legal profession. At one time, this nation had three branches of government: the executive, the legislative, the judicial. Now we have only one, the lawyers. Let me give you just one example of the type of incestuous relationships they create and how it affects the rest of us. A fellow named S. Hugh Dillon ran for governor of Indiana some years back. The voters rejected him, saying, in effect, they did not want him ruling over them. So he retired and never bothered the people of Indiana again, right? Wrong. At least if he had been elected and misbehaved, the voters could have thrown him out on his ear at the end of his first term. What happened was Dillon's fellow lawyers and political cronies got him appointed as a federal judge for the Southern District of Indiana. The reason I use him as an example, while there are hundreds of similar ones, is that he was the first federal judge I ever bested on an appeal. His judgment on the case was so asinine that even the Seventh Circuit Court of Appeals commented on it. This case is known in the law books as Cox versus Benson, etc. In a later chapter, I will show you how to read, understand, and reference law books. Dillon is still on the federal bench. Since federal judges are appointed for life, there is simply no way to get rid of him, almost. What the three branches of government being controlled by lawyers means to anyone trying to buck the government is that they are not dealing with law, but with lawyers, which means personalities. And the higher you go, the more obvious it becomes. Probably the most obvious example is Chief Justice Warren E. Burger's statement, quoted in The Brethren, "We're the Supreme Court and we can do what we want." Nor is this a new way of doing anything. In the 1930s, FDR tried to pack the federal court with men of his own choosing, making it self-evident that the law of the land depended not a whit upon justice, but simply upon the personalities of the men sitting on the bench. Richard Nixon was somewhat more successful. In some ways, today's Supreme Court could be referred to as Nixon's revenge. This business of judgment by personality extends all the way down through the federal system and into some of the states. What I hope to do is teach you how to cope with it. In all fairness, there are some decent judges, primarily at the state level. There's a good reason for this. Here in Kentucky, judges are elected to office. Further, it is a nonpartisan office. That is, no political party can profit by putting their man in office, and the judge can be tossed out if he misbehaves. The first time I appeared in a civil action in Kentucky, I was flabbergasted. The judge did absolutely everything according to the rules. In federal court, a non-lawyer fighting his own case is normally treated and looked upon as a species of life somewhat lower than a cockroach. The federal system is a classic example of how not to do things. Federal judges are appointed for life, supposedly in order to keep them from bowing to political pressures, to preserve the integrity of the judiciary, to keep them free from corruption, etc. Unfortunately, such a program has exactly the opposite effect. What happens is that federal judges inhabiting a position that it takes a satchel of dynamite to dislodge them from can become unbelievably arrogant and totally irresponsible. You'll learn more and how to cope with them later in this book. Ironically, at the very moment I was writing these lines, my secretary came in with my November 10, 1980, Volume 3, Number 9 copy of the National Law Journal. On the cover is an article about a federal judge in Cleveland named Frank Battisti, I remember this name, who is busily at the moment cramming forced busing down everyone's throats. His is a classic case of rule by lawyers, and it's typical. Appointed to the bench by President Kennedy, a member of the executive branch of government, mandated forced busing on Cleveland citizens, a legislative function. Forced busing was never a law passed by Congress. Took over the Cleveland School Board, an executive function at the state level. Federal judges arrogating power to themselves, the Constitution or the Congress never intended, has been fairly common since Andrew Jackson's term in office. It should be obvious to a child that the only way to stop this nonsense is to make a federal judgeship an elective office the way we do it with state judgeships here in Kentucky. Of course, That would leave the political parties nowhere to dump their political and legal dinosaurs. Which brings us back to the legal dinosaurs, the lawyers, to do battle with an opposing side on a lawsuit, and the lawyer or lawyers on it, keep one further thing in mind. Law is not a discipline like chemistry or physics. It does not require the years of training that, for example, a good machinist or mechanic must have. It is merely a collection of indexed paragraphs, just like you would find in a comprehensive set of encyclopedias written in plain English and presided over by personalities, judges, and men who have an incredibly exaggerated opinion of their own intelligence, lawyers. All that is actually necessary for the practice of law is a good grasp of English and the instruction necessary to use the indexing system to find what you want. English comprehension you should have learned in high school. This book will teach you the indexing system and a lot more. Okay. How to sue. Now, this really breaks it all down. It's just great. It recommends civil actions instead of criminal, and it explains why. And, this first case is the one where he didn't want to print the guy's real name or the real docket numbers. And it explains all the terms. The plaintiff is the one filing the complaint and everything like that. All these little numbers and everything, it explains what they are. Here's a funny article. He wanted a refund but wound up with an apartment complex. That was pretty good. And it explains about how to, instead of getting into a fight with somebody and being charged probably with assault and battery, to law them, as he says, they say in Kentucky. And here is a neighbor of his who shot his dog, and this guy just ran roughshod all over the neighbor. This is just great. And again, it explains the terminology. Everything is typed out, so you can see the forms and everything, the style and the form used. It blew up in the, this is one description of what's going on here. It blew up in the attorney's face. At the hearing, with judge, stenographer, attorney, and plaintiff present, the attorney kept repeating, "I don't know how to cope with this," over and over. Yeah. He got a federal judge to behave, and this was the dog case going on and on and on. And the person who countersued him ended up getting really a lot of legal bills due. And I don't even think this guy collected on them. He was really happy. The whole thing cost him, I think, I was way under $100. And, you know, there's the transcripts of a court reporter and everything, you know. And it just breaks down everything, you know. It's just wonderful. Now, this is nothing. It tells about countersuing, and here's a case. Oh, yeah, the dog thing, I think it cost, less than $50. Okay. Now, here are some forms, and you can see what was filled out. This was from a business that was stiffing him. It was screwing him. And they took the matter to small claims court, and he answered very properly, answer and counterclaim, and said this shouldn't be in small claims court because, and he gave the reason, which was completely valid, and he got this guy with thousands of dollars due. Now, this thing, this is about how to form a corporation. And he did it for just under $50, and that includes 2 to 3 hours of his time at what, well, he figured $10 an hour, because this was back almost 40 years ago. Now, this explains all of the, you know, like what the books are called, where to look in the library, where to find a law library, and which ones to avoid. And now here's something about treason and how to accuse somebody of treason and exactly what to do about it. How to inform yourself. This guy, Mike Brown, was into constitutional law. And he talked to me about this a lot because I ended up, well, I worked in the legal profession. I ended up not going to law school. I did really well on the LSAT, and I got the Series 6 and 63 licenses to sell financial products. You know, I was a member of National Association of Securities Dealers, and I was selling insurance and stuff, you know. But I was a paralegal in the States, and I was a paralegal here in France, and it cites a lot of interesting cases, such as Tokyo Rose. The U.S. tried to bust her for treason, and that didn't stick. It's really cool. It takes you all through this. And I just really recommend this book. You know, if you can find a copy of this secondhand, I would say just jump on it, you know. Who made the rules? You shouldn't even have to ask. Lawyers, of course. Explains the whole system. Now, this is very interesting. This explains about gun control, the 1968 Gun Control Act, and the constitutional aspects of this. And actually, he he has it all worked out here about how the Bible indicates that you should have the right to bear arms, and that the U.S. Guarantees you the right to, you know, do your religion. It's really an interesting approach. And this goes into the Bible. He was really into the Bible. He did all these books on the Bible and stuff like that. And I really, you know, I really enjoyed talking to him on the phone. Hours and hours I talked to him. And there was some really wild stuff about him as to why he was a convicted felon. It had something to do with attempting to blow up the United Nations because of a statue there that looked like Poseidon or something like that. I didn't really want to go there. Okay, making a judge behave. oh, yeah. This was, not only did he make a judge behave, but he had these clerks of the court just messing with him. And he successfully got them for treason. And it just takes you through the whole thing. And I know that this stuff still applies. And if it does not apply, if it's no longer the case, you have everything here, and you can check. It tells you where to look in the book, in the books and stuff for the updates. All right, this is so funny, and I use this book a lot. It's got a lot of post-its on it. I really found this very, very, very useful. And you can have this book if you want. You can buy it from me, or we can barter for it. I've got so many notes here. I did comparative legal seminars here in France, and I had to really pull this stuff out of my you-know-what. I had to create the whole programs and everything, and do these 2 days. That's who I used to do want them for a while. Franco-Britannique Chambre de Commerce. All right. The Anglo-Saxon legal system. How it varies from the French legal system. Oh, I didn't know. I didn't know that. Ah, here's what they gave the notaire who attended. I didn't even realize I had that. Okay. Now, what else do we have in here? Well, this gives you some idea. I think, oops, that camera strap is in the way. This gives you some idea. And, oh, I have questioned people on YouTube about Black's legal dictionary, and apparently Mike Brown did refer to it. And he said that that's what lawyers would keep around, and... Oh, here's that guy Battisti in Cleveland, Ohio. See, I remember him, Frank Battisti. He said that they keep Blacks around for when lawyers can't figure out what words mean. So, you know, my apologies. I had never used it. I had never seen it in a law library. Okay, that's been my experience. So... A lot of sample documents here. This is just great reading. It's in very simple layman's terms, you know. The appeal is beautifully... well, it's just great reading, but it's beautifully arranged and, you know, there are... It's neatly typed and typeset and... So anyway, Brown's Lawsuit Cookbook. I really don't need this anymore. Breaking the System. And if you think you could use this, you should get in touch with me. Original Document Reproductions. Yeah, these were the actual, some of the actual documents that he did himself, really. Nearly always. Okay, so if you want this, see this breaks down the system and explains the American legal system, and pages are flipping around. Really, really cool book. Yeah, how to arrange, it's everything like how to arrange your files and, you know, it's just so cool. I really, really found this very, very useful. And, ooh, funny, too. And I didn't want to become a lawyer. All right, there you go. Brown's Lawsuit Cookbook, book review. Bye.